Would like to welcome all of you in this online lecture series that has been organized jointly by the Department of English, Kharagpur College, and the Department of English, Agra Sarada Soshi Bhushan College. Today, we are actually honored and privileged to have Professor Indranil Acharya, our respected ISA, among us as a resource person. Let me please introduce our today's resource person. Professor Indranil Acharya, presently a professor of English at Vidyasagar University, has an illustrious academic career, a doyen in the field of literature of the marginalized, Dalit as well as tribal. In translation, he has his area of interest includes written languages, oral literature, tribal culture, documentation, translation, and analysis of endangered folk drama of West Bengal. And in most of these fields, he has emerged as a pioneering figure. Professor Acharya has a good number of published books under his name as author, editor, co-editor, and translator, and has published numerous scholarly articles in reputed journals, both in India and in abroad. He also has completed 4 UGC funded projects till now, member of several learned associations like Indian Folklore Congress, Central Sahitya Academy, National Editorial Collective of People's Linguistic Survey of India, Indian Association for the Study of Australia. Professor Acharya presently is a UGC awarded visiting fellow at the Department of English, Delhi University. We are really fortunate to have such a distinguished speaker among us. And we express our heartfelt gratitude to Professor Indranil Acharya for giving his kind consent and managing his busy schedule. Today, Professor Acharya will enrich and illumine us with his speech on Dalit literature and overview. Sir, can't wait anymore. Please take the session and enrich us. Over to you, sir. Sir, kindly unmute your microphone, please.
Hello, good afternoon.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Good afternoon, all the participants in today's webinar. And I would like to thank the organizers of this webinar. That is Kharagpur College and Agra SSB College authorities, faculty members, and all others who had been instrumental in organizing this webinar today. In fact, it had been a series of online lectures which both the colleges have decided to organize and hold, and I welcome all of you, and I'm very happy that such an initiative has been taken by these colleges, you know, jointly, collaboratively. And as I believe that this lecture platform is primarily meant for the present students of both these colleges, I will try to address those students particularly. And I will try to introduce, you know, Dalit literature to the students of the undergraduate and postgraduate programs in both these colleges, because I have been told that Kharagpur College is already offering post-graduation in English literature. It's really a very pleasant occasion to be with you this afternoon. And as I see Pathik, my ex-student here, I feel very inspired, because, you know, we are happy. We are glad that our ex-students are now well placed in various colleges and universities of West Bengal and other states. So definitely Vidyasagar University Department of English is proud of all such successful ex-students of our department. I know that there are other, you know, ex-students and current students in the MPhil and PhD programs of our university. I know that they are there. I know, am I audible to all of you? Hello? Pothik, am I audible right now?
Yes,
you are audible. Okay. So I have decided primarily to address the students, and I know that there are other students as well, our ex-students, our MPhil and PhD scholars, and many others who are interested in Dalit literature. I'm really happy to address all of you. As you know, I have made it a point to introduce our students and also to other interested participants to the curriculum of Dalit literature in Vidyasagar University. If you look at the syllabus of Dalit literature, which is in the fourth semester, that is 404B Dalit literature, you would find that in the first unit, we have decided to include Dalit autobiographies, because all of us know that Dalit autobiographies are the most authentic representations of Dalit consciousness. All of us who have studied Dalit literature know the importance of Dalit consciousness, because Dalit authors have also been talking about Dalit consciousness, and this is something which makes all the Dalit writers unique in terms of the experiential quality of their narratives. So whatever they have felt and experienced, particularly the experiences of pain and suffering, the experience of humiliation, a very important experience, and also the other allied experiences of anger and revolt to a certain extent. So if we look at Dalit autobiographies, we find that they are probably the most authentic expression of Dalit worldview. In fact, if you read articles by Pramod Nair, okay, you will come to know how Pramod wants to describe Dalit autobiographies as, you know, Dalit testimonials. And I hope all of you know that testimonials, once again, are very popular kind of, you know, genre in the context of Latin American literature, where we come across writers like Rigoberta Menchú and many, many other, you know, Latin American activists, writers, okay, who had been victims of state-sponsored oppression. And we know many of them, you know, writers of indigenous communities who had experienced physical, mental, and spiritual torture at different points of time, okay, and who have seen many of their comrades losing their lives in course of torture and punishment. So, testimonio, once again, with its strong legal, you know, association, is one term that we can also use in connection with the Dalit autobiographies. In fact, apart from testimonial, we also use the term, you know, life writings. And life writings, once again, is a concept which we find in abundance in the writings of Australian Aboriginal authors, okay, Aboriginal writers, you know, like many others, many of them are there. And we can think of Kim Scott, we can think of Ujjeru, we can think of Mudruru, and many other Australian Aboriginal authors, okay, who had recorded the pain and suffering, the humiliation and insult, okay, the feelings of anger and revolt through their life writings. So autobiographies, life writings, and testimonials, all of them have a kind of association which speaks volumes of the social, cultural, political, economic, and even legal, you know, experiences of marginalization, subjugation, and indiscrimination of different marginalized communities. So Dalit is one such umbrella term in the Indian subcontinent, which includes the experiences of all such marginalized, minor, subjugated, victimized communities. Okay, it may include the SCs, it may also include the STs, it may include the OBCs, and in a very broad sense, it may include all other categories of marginalization, like say women, children, even of the unreserved categories. So Dalitization is, from that point of view, a symbolic term which denotes and connotes to any kind of unjust social practice and behavior experienced by certain members of our community. So in the first unit, you will find that we have included three major autobiographies. Okay, Bama's Karukku, a seminal work of a very famous Dalit woman writer of autobiography. Okay, another one is by Om Prakash Valmiki, Jhutan. Okay, all of us have read it. Okay, a wonderful, poignant record of the victimization and humiliation of Dalits in the context of North India. Om Prakash Valmiki's Jhutan. And the third one is by Lakshman Rao Gaikwad, okay, The Branded. I know that some of the institutions don't offer this text for classroom teaching, but Lakshman Rao Gaikwad belongs to a slightly different category. No, he doesn't belong to that category of untouchable Dalits in that sense. Rather, he belongs to the category of the denotified tribes, DNTs. You know that you are aware of that infamous, you know, criminal act, Criminal Aborigines Act, Criminal Tribes Act of 1871, passed by the British government, and how, you know, certain forest tribes were targeted and punished as a result of that Criminal Tribes Act because they had protested against the British annexation of the forest land. They had protested for their survival and livelihood. So they had to pay a very heavy price of being branded as criminals. Even after independence in 1952, this infamous act was repealed, the Criminal Tribes Act, and they were denotified. They were denotified in 1952. But even after, say, 68 years of this denotification, even in 2020, we find that many of these people in the erstwhile criminal tribe category have to carry the social stigma, the ignominy of being branded as thieves or dacoits or robbers, okay, criminals. Okay, even today, you know, if there is any case of any petty theft, you would find that, especially I give you an example, in the West Midnapur district and Jhadgram district, you know, the Lodhas are there, Lodha Shabar. They were earlier, you know, branded as criminal tribes by the British. Even today, you know, many Lodha young men are arrested without warrant, if there is any case of theft or robbery or whatever. And they are forced to act as receivers by certain, you know, gangs which operate in the railway colonies. Apart from that, in Purulia, you would find another tribal community, Khediya, Khediya Shabor. Khediyas were also branded by the British as criminal tribes. Even today, the Khediyas have to bear the brunt of that criminalization. Okay, you may think of the famous case of Budhan Shabar. Budhan Shabar was tortured and murdered in police custody in the 1980s. And after the, you know, death of Budhan Shabar, Mahashweta Devi, late Mahashweta Devi, led a great movement, a political movement, for the punishment of the police officers who were responsible for the custodial death of Budhan Shabar. And there was a great movement In fact, in the 1980s, we find there was the constitution of the Ganguly Commission, and there were reports of it, and many other things happened at that point of time. And later what happened, that Budhan became a name of protests all over India. And Budhan's death and Budhan's sacrifice inspired another erstwhile criminal tribe living in Ahmedabad, Gujarat. The name of this tribe is Chhara tribe. They were inspired by Budhan's story, and they developed a community protest theater in memory of Budhan Shabar, and it was called Budhan Theater. Budhan Theater was created in Gujarat, Ahmedabad, and it was directed by a graduate, the first graduate of the Chhara tribe, Dakshin Bajrangi. Dakshin Bajrangi was the director. And so look how Dakshin inspired other members of the Chhara community, and they enacted, they performed Budhan story in different forums. They also went abroad. And recently, they have come up with a cinematic version of Budhan story. And it has been produced by a professor in America, Henry Swartz. The movie was released very recently. It was modeled on the life of Budhan Shabar. So look how, the denotified tribes were highly neglected and relegated to the background, how they were victims of cultural amnesia in the Indian context. Many of us don't know really who are the denotified tribes, but they are mostly, nomadic tribes. They don't reside in a particular place for a long period of time. They move from one place to another because of that social stigma, because of many other socioeconomic factors. So when what happened, that Lakshman Gaikwad, if you read the autobiography of Lakshman Gaikwad, the branded, very significant, because how are they criminalized? How are these people branded as criminals in society? It's a soul-stirring narrative. It's a highly emotional narrative. If you read it, you will be able to understand the aesthetics of Dalitization. You will understand the dynamics of Dalitization. So this is what we have in the first unit of Dalit literature. In the second unit, we have included certain samples of what we should call protest writings. Protest writings by eminent Dalit authors. And the first one, all of us know, it's a very important speech by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Dr. Ambedkar's speech at Mahad. At Mahad in Maharashtra, there was a non-violent protest movement initiated by the untouchables under the leadership of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. It happened way back in 1927. There was Mahad Satyagraha. The first time it happened in March. And when Dr. Ambedkar led hundreds of peaceful protesters to the temple, to the local temple, because they wanted to drink water from the tank, of the neighboring tank of the temple, but they were denied water. Even the cattle reared by the Dalits were allowed to drink water, but the Dalit people were not allowed to drink water. So this movement to Chavadar tank at Mahad was actually a movement for reclaiming human rights for Dalit people. Today we talk about indigenous human rights, Dalit human rights. But look how almost 100 years ago, way back in 1927, Dr. Ambedkar had been leading a very peaceful procession for reclaiming what we call Dalit human rights. So we have included that speech because in the first movement, in March 1927, what happened? Dr. Ambedkar and his associates were attacked by the security men of the temple, and they were physically tortured. And Dr. Ambedkar also received injuries, multiple injuries. Okay, there was police case. And you know that British didn't spare the upper castes. Okay, many of those, you know, perpetrators of violence were booked by the law and they were put behind the bars. Okay, and later what happened on 25th December, 1927, Dr. Ambedkar, once again observed the day as what? As Manusmriti Dahan Day, the burning of the copy of Manusmriti, because Manu Sanghita was considered to be the root text for the practice of untouchability, for the introduction of caste-based discrimination in the Indian subcontinent. So Manusmriti was burnt there, copies of the book. And then also in the second Satyagraha movement, Dr. Ambedkar rendered that famous speech to all his followers. And what was there in that famous speech? Dr. Ambedkar repeatedly emphasized the need to introduce the concept of inter-caste marriage, because that was, according to Dr. Ambedkar, the most important way to abolish the practice of untouchability in Indian subcontinent. And intermarriage was the most effective way to do away with the caste-based discriminatory social system of India. Okay, so that was, if you read the essay, you will come to know how he uses several anecdotes from Mahabharata, from, Roman political system, from French Revolution, and other things to highlight and substantiate his core argument. So this is really, a very important text, a landmark text, Dr. Ambedkar's speech at Mahad, which would give the students a very good idea about the concept of untouchability, about the practice of untouchability, about the evolution of the idea of untouchability, and about the remedial measures to do away with the practice of untouchability. And another, text which we have included in this unit is by Limbale, Charan Kumar Limbale, Towards an Aesthetic of Dalit Literature. Okay, this is a cult text of Dalit literature, particularly Dalit criticism. And you know that we don't have, perhaps till date, we don't have any other, more authentic work of literary criticism in the domain of Dalit literature that is available in English translation, Towards an Aesthetic of Dalit Literature. Okay, Om Prakash Valmiki has written An Aesthetic of Dalit Literature, but that is available in Hindi. That is not yet available in standard English translation. Okay, but Limbale's text is a very authoritative, a very descriptive, and in a way very philosophical, description of different tenets of Dalit literature. Okay, differences between Ambedkarite literature and Marxist literature. Difference between mainstream Sahitya and Dalit Sahitya, and many other issues. Okay, what are the rasa theory of mainstream poetics? What are the additional rasas which we come across in Dalit literature? How can these additional rasas be established successfully in the Indian context? All such ideas are there in this seminal text. And apart from that, we have a third text here by a very famous Dalit woman author, Baby Kamble. The Prisons We Broke. The Prisons We Broke is another very important, prose, Protestant prose, a prose that clearly and categorically, delineates the experiences of women, particularly Dalit women, in the caste-ridden social system of India. and how Baby Kamble comes across the several experiences of torture and humiliation, not only from the upper caste men, but also from Dalit men of her own community. Okay, the atrocities, the torture which people of their own community perpetrate on them every day, every night. Okay, so it's a very important text. Now, in Unit 3, the final unit of Dalit literature, we have included Dalit poetry. Okay, and Dalit poetry, we have mentioned here as text, recommended text, Anthology of Dalit Poetry, edited by Mulk Raj Anand and Eleanor Zelliot. I hope you have this book in your library, and I hope that students of these colleges have a copy of this book. This is a very important book. It was published much earlier in the 1990s. And it's a very significant anthology of Marathi Dalit poetry. And apart from that, we have also mentioned another text, recommended another text, you know, Poisoned Bread, edited by Arjun Dangle, which is a cult text of a cult anthology of Dalit literature, edited by Arjun Dangle way back in 1992, and which can easily be said to have pioneered this practice of Dalit literature in English translation, and in a way consolidating the Dalit literary movement in the Indian subcontinent. So Poisoned Bread is a landmark work which we have recommended, and in which you will find several poems and stories which may be offered in classroom teaching by the concerned teacher. And the second one was Poisoned Bread. The third and final text which we have recommended in the course of Dalit literature is Survival and Other Stories. And here we take a kind of collective pride. We, the faculty members in the Department of English, are very happy to announce to our ex-students and present students of Vidyasagar University, and also other interested listeners to this webinar from other universities, that this anthology of short stories, Bangla Dalit Short Stories, Survival and Other Stories, edited by Professor Shankar Prasad Singho and myself, is the first anthology of Dalit stories in Bangla. It is the first anthology of Bangla Dalit short stories available in English translation. It was published in 2012, and Survival and Other Stories had already been, you know, a very popular text in the domain of Dalit studies. Okay. One interviewer asked Om Prakash Valmiki, when he was on his hospital bed, almost his last days, one interviewer asked Om Prakash Valmiki, have you read any sample of Bangla Dalit literature? Okay, Valmiki replied, yes, Survival and Other Stories. So Survival and Other Stories has been able to represent the unrepresented domain of Bangla Dalit literature, which began more or less in the early part of 1990s, and which coincided with the unfortunate death of Chuni Kotal, Bangla Dalit literature, which had been available in Bengali for the last, say, two decades, could not have in that sense a national and global readership because of a lack of English translation. We attempted to bridge that gap, and we came up with that anthology as part of our UGC Special Assistance Program, Departmental Research Support Scheme, way back in 2009-10. It was a publication of the first phase of this project, Survival and Other Stories, in which you will find a selection of representative Bangla Dalit narratives from different corners of West Bengal, and you would find how different communities of Dalit people have recorded their experiences of pain and suffering, of humiliation, of having been betrayed and cheated by the upper caste in their own narratives, with the help of their own regional variations, linguistic variations, dialectal variations, and also a world of Dalit consciousness, which we can clearly experience in these narratives. So this is, in a nutshell, you know, a brief overview of Dalit literature as we have been able to offer to our students of undergraduate and postgraduate programs in Vidyasagar University. And you will also be happy to know that Vidyasagar University is arguably the first state university which had introduced Dalit literature at the undergraduate and postgraduate levels, for compulsory study, for compulsory reading. So other universities have followed, and today we are very happy to find that some premier universities and institutes of India and also of West Bengal have taken up Dalit literature in a very serious way. And some of them have also been running, you know, projects, UGC and other projects on Dalit literature, on Dalit studies quite successfully. We are very happy to know that, because we had pioneered such a movement which had been transmitted to other institutions of higher education, and they have come up with their own ideas of research and development in the area, and thereby they have contributed to the enrichment of this domain of study. We are really very happy. Now I would like to move on to some basics of Dalit literature, because I know that your teachers in both the colleges would definitely discuss the texts which are included in the syllabus. In fact, they have already discussed it. It's in the course of fourth semester. So fourth semester has already successfully completed, say, both offline mode and online mode of teaching. So you are well aware of the texts, and you have come across different interpretations and readings of the text in the classroom and also outside the classroom, in the offline and in the online modes of teaching. So I would like to give you some basic ideas about, you know, literary representation of Dalits, because that is one important area, that is one important background study which all of us should do in order to understand the texts which are incorporated in the university syllabus. So if we look at the literary representation of Dalits, we find that generally they had been excluded untouchables, and they had remained invisible in the canonical literary texts of India. Okay, for many centuries, the untouchables had remained excluded in the literary corpus. In fact, if we look till the end of 19th century, we find very few study of social oppression. And in the 20th, especially, you know, in the latter half of the 20th century and in the early 21st century, we find there is a growing representation of Dalits. Dalits in the ontological sense, and also Dalit in a very symbolic sense, okay, in a very consolidated and inclusive sense. Okay, outcasts, landless people, dispossessed people, and also indigenous population. So we find in the late 20th and early 21st centuries the growing representation of Dalits. Now the questions are, you know, when did Dalit literature take shape? We shall definitely discuss it. And I hope you are aware of the earliest days of Dalit literature, how it was influenced by the great Dalit ideologues and stalwarts like Jyotiba Rao Phule and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. And you know that how the Panthers movement and other associated movements internationally inspired and shaped the future course of Dalit literature. So when did Dalit literature take shape? That is one question. Another question, what was the historical moment leading to its emergence? Historical moment, yes. Okay, we shall be reading about, you know, Dr. Ambedkar's lifelong struggle for the establishment of a separate Dalit identity in the form of a separate Dalit electorate, and how the political accumulation of power was very important for Dr. Ambedkar to assert Dalit rights, to reclaim Dalit human rights, and how, you know, Dr. Ambedkar's conversion to Buddhism in the last years of his life, and how the impact of this mass conversion to Buddhism had in a way prepared the moment for the birth of Dalit movement as a whole, and how that Dalit movement naturally led to the emergence of Dalit literature. So what was the historical moment leading to its emergence? That is another question. And the third question is, what is its philosophy? Yes, definitely, if we read Dr. Ambedkar, if we read other very important Dalit scholars, say up to the point of Kancha Ilaya, why I am not a why I am a Dalit, or in a way, why he in a way relinquished, you know, Hinduism, why I am not a Hindu. So Kancha Ilaya, up to Kancha Ilaya, if you look at different Dalit ideologues, you would find how the philosophy had been developed over many decades by major Dalit, you know, activists, writers, and reformists, and how they had attempted to philosophize the basic theoretical formulations of Dalitism, and how they had contributed to the formation of Dalit identity in the true sense of the term. So caste as power is a very important aspect of, you know, Dalit identity, of understanding, you know, representation or non-representation of Dalits in literature. Caste as a very powerful weapon. Foucault's theory of knowledge, all of us know that theory of knowledge and power, and this can be applied to know the mechanism of Dalit oppression, because the control of the production of knowledge is very important. The control over the production and dissemination of knowledge, okay, is definitely related to the idea of domination over knowledge system. And people who had dominated the knowledge system, who had been absorbed in the production and dissemination of knowledge system almost as a form of monopoly, okay, had always in a way victimized and excluded a large number of people from the domain of knowledge production and dissemination. And this exclusion was deliberate to establish their hegemony of high caste, that is pervasive, as knowledge was produced by them. So other people were, okay, forced into a state of ignorance, into a state of non-knowledge. And caste as power, once again, if you look at the history of learning of Sanskrit, you would find how it was deliberately reserved as a privilege for the upper castes. Okay, as it happened, if you read the history of English literature, you would find how, you know, the knowledge of Latin was reserved for only the ecclesiastical people, only the clergymen, only the church scholars, okay, and how the laity, the common people, okay, were denied, okay, access to Latin, okay, the learning of Latin. So Dalits and women particularly were debarred from the learning of Sanskrit. Okay, and this non-proliferation of Sanskrit, once again, was a deliberate mechanism for the brute assertion of power, of caste power. And this brute assertion of power was, once again, okay, a very nasty political ploy to perpetuate the domination of the upper castes, perpetuate the process of domination of the upper castes, and to create a system of subsidiary, subjugated, okay, almost enslaved people, almost in a state of slavery, to create a section of population that would continue almost in a state of slavery. Hence, for centuries, Dalits were at the periphery. The goods produced by these Dalit people, okay, the labor which went into the production of these goods, okay, was accepted, but they were excluded. As you would find in that irony, okay, how the water from the Chavadar tank was admissible for drinking to the animals, okay, of the Dalit people, but how that water was not allowed to the Dalit human beings. Okay, that was the irony. So reading and writing was were not allowed to, you know, the outcasts, and how this, you know, lack of access to the traditional system of learning, to the traditional system of education, was once again a brute assertion of the upper caste hegemonic system. Okay, how the creative talent of these outcast people, okay, was expressed in folk performances. In fact, during our research of the endangered folk performance traditions of Bengal, we have come across many such folk traditions, like, you know, Bhad Jatra, a very popular folk drama form of South Bengal. Okay, like, you know, other, you know, very interesting, you know, performances, okay, like Alkap, a very popular, you know, folk drama form in the North Bengal part. So if you look at these folk performance traditions, you would find that only the Dalit people, only the socially excluded and the socially ignoble, you know, people were allowed to engage in such creative manifestations. Okay, and they were rejected by the upper caste as polluting. And you know that many women could not attend to such performances because they were restrained by the men folk, upper caste men folk. And even what happened that in many of these performances, women were not allowed, men performed the role of women. So untouchable artists were forced to work as, you know, virtual slaves. So caste as power, we find, had been there, okay, in the history of India. Okay, in the golden age of Gupta dynasty, you know, the upper caste art flourished. Okay, upper caste art, different forms of manifestation. Kalidasa, you know, was the major poet of the Gupta dynasty. And in his Avijnana Shakuntalam, if you read it, you would find that the fisherman, okay, who belongs to that outcast community, you know, so a fisherman is depicted as a thief, okay, who had stolen the gold ring of King Dushmanta. Okay. So there is a trend to criminalize the untouchables. Okay. And we don't find any alternative narrative, okay, for self-representation of the outcasts. Okay. If we go back, okay, to the history of India. And in the Bhakti movement, if you come to the Bhakti movement, which went on for almost 1000 years, 8th to 18th century, we find for the first time the voices of the untouchable saint poets. So Bhakti movement is a major phenomenon in the Indian subcontinent because it gave rise to the voice of the saint poets, many of whom emerged from the so-called, you know, untouchable castes. Okay, and the most important one you have heard of, his name, Chokha Mela, who was a Mahad saint poet of Maharashtra. Okay, and Chokha Mela wrote songs glorifying the greatness of the god, the Lord God, Vithoba. Okay, an incarnation of Lord Vishnu. So, and his songs were known as Abhang. Okay, Chokha Mela, who came from the Mahad community, an untouchable caste. Okay, so in his Abhang, we find Chokha Mela expressed, okay, his sincere, okay, sense of protest against untouchability. And Chokha Mela, you know, was not allowed to enter the temple of Lord Vithoba, but Lord Vithoba, okay, had actually descended and he had talked to Chokha Mela. Okay, he was very fond of Chokha Mela. He also gifted his own necklace to Chokha Mela, but he was blamed later as a thief for stealing the god's necklace. So if you look at the story of Chokha Mela, and if you read some of his abhangs, okay, you would find that how there was the first voice of the untouchables, okay, heard through his abhangs, through his songs, devotional songs, which are actually protests against the atrocities of the upper castes. I read a few lines from one of his abhangs, Chokha Mela's abhang. Why have you thrown this challenge, God? Solve this riddle of mine. Enter my shoes. Know in your own self an outcast. What rights do I enjoy? Says Chokha, this low-born human body everyone drives away. Doubts prey on my mind. What can I do? What can I do? Look at the sense of helplessness. I am an outcast. Oh God, if you don't help me, what can I do as an outcast? So we find how this is also a picture which I have downloaded from the net. Especially for the students, you will get many images of Chokha Mela if you search on the internet. But look how Chokha Mela is definitely the first, you know, Dalit saint poet, okay, who had come up with his abhangs as protest literature, okay, against untouchability, the practice of untouchability. And in bhakti movement, we come across other, you know, saint poets as well who represented different low caste, lower castes of society. You know, that Namdev, who was a tailor, Kabir was a weaver, Ravidas was a cobbler, then Dadu Dayal and Sena, okay, all of them, okay, hailed from different low castes. But this regional writing, once again, bhakti movement, okay, could not cast a great national impact because of the regional writing in the regional languages, and there was lack of translation into English. Okay, and later we find with the advent of the British in India, there was a change of condition of the untouchables. We all know the activities of the missionaries. We all know about the attitude of British administration regarding the practice of untouchability, and how, you know, the English education in India in a way changed the plight of the Dalits to a certain extent. In fact, the 1835, you know, Macaulay minutes, okay, what we know, it introduced a new language hierarchy. All of us know that in the Indian caste structure, it's a new hierarchy with English as a very respected language of the colonizer. So it gained an uppermost position in the new language hierarchy. The upper castes, you know, who were earlier skilled in Sanskrit and Persian, you know, during the Hindu and Islamic regimes, okay, now learnt the new language, English, the colonizer's language, the language of the power, the language of the center. Okay, they were now proficient in English language. And what happened? The Dalits were again excluded because they didn't have that chance to enter into the academic institutions. That was a problem. But the 19th century Indian Renaissance, if you look at the rise of different social reformers in Bengal and other provinces of India, in 19th century Indian Renaissance, we find there was a change in the old orthodoxies of caste and gender to a large extent. There were major reforms. All of us know that, okay, regarding women's education, widow remarriage, then equality before God. We know about, you know, the reformist movements of Raja Ram Mohan Roy, Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa, Swami Vivekananda, and many others, Dayanand Saraswati, and many other people, the reformers, okay, who wanted to revolutionize the caste-based discriminatory social structure of Hinduism. No, and but in creative literature, once again, outcasts were still invisible. They were not represented in a big way in the creative literature. In fact, education, as I have mentioned, gradually proved to be an emancipatory exercise for the Dalit people with the advent of the colonial educational system. Christian missionaries introduced untouchable children, you know, to school, and later Jyotiba Rao Phule and Savitri Bai Phule, they opened school for untouchables. You know that both of them had an exemplary service. They rendered exemplary service during the devastating plague at Pune. And you know, Savitri Bai worked a lot for the girl students, and how she moved from door to door, you know, to inspire the Dalit families to send their girl children to schools, and how she created a new renaissance, especially amongst the Dalit women of Maharashtra. And today we know that to honor the contribution of Savitri Bai Phule, you know, Pune University, the very reputed university of Western India, Pune University has been named after, renamed as Savitri Bai Phule Pune University. And Mukta Bai, I would like to talk about Mukta Bai, who was a student of this Phule school. Okay, and she published in 1855 an essay in Marathi. Okay, if we translate it into English, the title will be About the Grief of the Monks and Mahats. Now, the monks and Mahats were both untouchable castes in Maharashtra, and they were hated, okay, despised, and very lowly held in society. Okay, and Mukta Bai's writing can be described as the earliest Dalit woman's writing, okay, in the Indian context. Mukta Bai's essay About the Grief of the Monks and Mahats. And this is a picture also of Mukta Bai, which I have downloaded again from internet. And I would advise the students to download other images of Mukta Bai and to collect information about Mukta Bai. She was the first one, the first, you know, major writer. As a Dalit woman, she wrote for the first time to describe the condition of Dalits, the untouchables. And she writes, I read one paragraph from his essay. Mukta Bai writes, "Oh, the Mahars and monks, you are poor and sick. Only the medicine of knowledge will cure and heal you. It will take you away from wild beliefs and superstitions. You will become righteous and moral. It will stop your exploitation. People who treat you like animals will not dare to treat like that anymore. So please work hard and study. Get educated and become good human beings." Look how Mukta Bai inspires. Mukta Bai inspires her fellow, you know, Dalit, you know, children, Dalit students, especially Dalit girls. How she inspires them to study very hard, as education only will be able to do away with the caste-based discrimination, as education alone could empower them. And look, when does he write this? She writes this in 1855, okay, much ahead of Dr. Ambedkar. Okay, Mukta Bai could also have been a great influence upon Dr. Ambedkar. Now, if we look at the treatment of caste in early modern literature, we find that upper caste writers depicted the untouchables, okay, or rather started depicting the untouchables only in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Okay, and we should first look at the condition of Kerala, because Kerala came up with certain works which were the first attempts to depict the life of the untouchables. Okay, the first one in Kerala, Ghataka Badham, no, the first text, okay, about the untouchables, the slayer slain, which was written and published around 1864-65 by Mrs. Collins, okay, who was an English missionary, okay, who worked with the untouchables and decided to write this work on the basis of our experience of working with the untouchable communities. So look at this foreigner's perspective on the miserable plight of untouchable communities in Kerala, 1864-65. The second one is by Potheri Punhambu. Punhambu himself hailed from a low caste. Potheri Kunhambu's Saraswati Bijayam. Saraswati Bijayam, which was published in 1892. And it tells us about the miserable life experiences of a Pulaya slave. Slavery was very much in practice in 19th century Kerala. So a Pulaya slave was tortured by a Nambudiri Brahmin landlord. The Brahmins tortured and enslaved the untouchable castes. And later in that story, we find later this Pulaya slave gained access to education. He came under the influence of Christian missionaries. He was converted to Christianity and he could receive the fruits of education and later became a judge of the High Court. And it was a strange coincidence, it was an irony of fate, that this judge later judged that Nambudiri Brahmin for one case of default and finally punished him, pronounced the verdict against him. So it was a kind of revenge which was taken by the untouchable person in that narrative. The third major one was by Joseph Mulliyil. Once again, a Malayalam writer, Sukumari, the title of the text, you know, published in 1897, where we once again find a narrative of conversion to Christianity for the scope of education. In fact, we find in Kerala, many of the untouchable castes under Hinduism, many of these people decided to convert to Christianity in order to lead a decent life, in order to receive the bare necessities of life from the Christian missionaries, and also by turn receive education and rise up in the social ladder. In Bengal, if we look at the 19th century situation in Bengal regarding the treatment of caste, we find there are a few discursive essays on caste. And the most important one is, the first one is Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay's essay, Samya, Equality, which refers to the oppression of the lower castes by the high caste countrymen. We are also very familiar with Tagore's essay, Nationalism. You have read it at the postgraduate level. Tagore, where he seeks justice for the lower castes, where he stresses the need for achieving social equality, the need to do away with social discrimination in order to create a genuine nationalistic feeling among all people. So Tagore on caste, we find in one poem, we know that a very famous poem where Tagore attacks the upper caste for the humiliation of the untouchables. Yes, all of us are familiar with that poem. I read the English translation of the poem. Hemor durbhaga desh jader korecho apoman apomane hote hobe tahader shobar shoman. Oh my fortunate country, those whom you have insulted, you will have to come down to their level through insults. So this is very important for a writer like Tagore, an upper caste writer who could clearly predict the future danger of Indian society if this ignominious tradition of humiliation, particularly meted out to the Dalit communities, untouchable communities, continue. So Tagore could in a way visualize the future problems through this poem, and it was a clear-cut statement of his disapproval of the system of untouchability. Now, if we look at one record of Indian novels with Dalit characters, I hope it will help you to connect it with the actual novels later produced by Dalit authors, okay, at a later stage, because you will be able to, you know, understand the growth and development of this tradition of portraying Dalits in Indian novels. Okay, if we look at that tradition, okay, I have provided here one catalog. We'll also get it in some important reference books on Dalit literature. I will definitely be referring to them at the end of my lecture. So one is by the Telugu writer Unnava Lakshmi Narayan. Malapalli is a very important work. It was published in 1921. It's also the first Indian novel that comes up with Dalit characters in a major way. No, Malapalli, 1921. In fact, this 1921 is also significant in the history of Bangla Dalit literature, because we find the first Bangla Dalit epic published in the year 1921 by one writer, Dalit writer, Rai Charan Bishwas. Rai Charan Bishwas publishes the first Bangla Dalit epic, Jatiyo Jagoron. Jatiyo Jagoron. It was not about national, you know, reawakening. It was actually about a caste reawakening. Jatiyo refers to Jati, that is the Namashudra community. So he writes about the renaissance of the Namashudra community in Bengal. That was also way back in 1921, Jatiyo Jagoron. Then in Hindi, Prem Chand's very famous work, Rangbhumi, published in 1925. Kannada, K. Sivarama Karan's Chomana Dudi, that was published in 1933. And in English, you are familiar with Mulk Raj Anand's work, Untouchable. It is included in the syllabus of many Indian universities, published in 1935. And then in Malayalam, T. Sivasankara Pillai, Thotti Ude Makan, in 1948. It's almost a chronological record of the novels published in India with Dalit characters. Kannada, very famous novels by U.R. Anantamurthy, Samskara. I hope all of us, especially the Vidyasagar University students, have read Samskara in the postgraduate syllabus. And Bharatipura, another one also depicting the Dalit characters. In Samskara, we have that unforgettable portrayal of Chandri, the Dalit woman, who played a major role in that novella. And we also find other works at a later stage when Dalit movement has taken momentum. Even at that point of time, other non-Dalit authors had been writing about Dalit characters in a big way. Roman Basu, Banomali Goswami, Rohinjan Mistry, and others, many others are there. Arundhati Roy's The God of Small Things, we know is a major epoch-making work, Indian English fiction, where we find a very emotional rendering of Velutha, the untouchable. And in the Malayalam context, we find how the untouchables were, in a way, cabined, cribbed and confined, and how there was a love, that intercaste love, and how it created a tragic consequence for both Ammu and also Velutha. So all of us have read about it, and there were many such works in India. Many Indian novels in English and other regional languages have depicted Dalit characters. But once again, I find that some of the Dalit critics and theorists categorically reject all these projections of Dalits in non-Dalit fiction as emotional literature, quote-unquote emotional literature. Why? Because this is imagined by the upper caste author. So when it is imagined by an upper caste author, it cannot be authentic. So there is a question of, once again, sincerity and authenticity. Sincerity of representation and authenticity of representation. The question is, okay, these non-Dalit authors, according to the Dalit critics, cannot have that unique Dalit consciousness of pain and suffering which had impelled the Dalit authors to record their own narratives of humiliation. Okay, so if you read a novel like Malapalli, you will be able to understand that how, you know, this unbridgeable gap between, you know, non-Dalit writings about Dalit life and Dalit's reception of the non-Dalit's representation of Dalit life, okay, are always, you know, in a term of, in a relationship of conflict. And there are many dissents, there are many debates and controversies regarding such representations. If we look at Gandhi and Ambedkar, we would also come to know about this, you know, how non-Dalit, you know, social reformer and the Dalit social reformer looked at the entire practice of Varnashrama Dharma in the Indian context and how they held opposite views. Okay, if we look at Gandhi's views on untouchability, you know, and the Varnashrama Dharma, okay, we find that Gandhi avoided competition among different castes and he preferred to maintain the status quo. Somehow the Varnashrama, as you know, also the justifiable basis of Karmashrama, and while Ambedkar considered that the caste-based structure was undemocratic because caste-based structure was, okay, principled on discrimination and exclusion, so it was also based on the idea of hatred, the idea of denial, the idea of, in a way, perpetuation of slavery. Okay, so such unequal system could never be democratic, and this divisive practice of Hindu caste system would finally lead to the division of the Indians, and it would make the Indians poor. It would make India as a weak nation because of this inherent divisions in terms of castes. So in 1932, after the Pune Pact, we know that with Ambedkar, Gandhi began the Harijan movement, and we know how Ambedkar was somehow, in a way, compelled to accept the terms and conditions, and how there was a pact, and how he had to accept it, and he had to give up the claim for a separate electorate for the Dalits. All of us know that, in a way, but I would like to read out in a one passage, okay, that is one observation of Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, on the practice of untouchability, because Gandhi was against the practice of untouchability, and that is why he decided to begin the Harijan movement. I just read one paragraph from his article in Young India, published on 15th January 1921. Has not a just nemesis overtaken us for the crime of untouchability? Have we not reaped as we have sown? Have we not practiced diarism or odwarism on our kith and kin? We have segregated the pariah, and we are in turn segregated in the British colonies. We deny him the use of public wealth. We throw the leavings of our plates at him. His very shadow pollutes us. Indeed, there is no charge that the pariah cannot fling in our face, which we do not fling in the faces of Englishmen. So look how Gandhi was definitely against the practice of untouchability. But at the same time, you know, Gandhi was in favor of continuing the Varnashrama Dharma for unifying the different castes under Hinduism. And that was essential for Gandhi to maintain the impression of unity, okay, united India, okay, fighting against colonial rule of the British government. So he had certain political compulsions, and at the same time Ambedkar didn't, or rather was unwilling to buy his theory, and he was adamant on the true emancipation of the Dalit population and the right to self-determination for the Dalit population. So the conflict continued. It was an unending conflict. So Dalit articulations in early 20th century, if we look at it, you know, you should note that the first major Dalit poet was Hira Dom, from the central provinces, and the poem An Untouchable's Complaint, the very significant poem in Hindi, the first major poem by an untouchable poet, a poem that talks about the double discrimination of Dalits under the colonial rule and also under the upper caste rulers. And regarding this, I would like to refer to one important work of criticism published in 2013. I have already mentioned it in the slide by Toral Jatin Gajarwala. Untouchable Fictions, Literary Realism and Crisis of Caste. So Crisis of Caste was once again a very important factor in the depiction of Dalits in the fictions of the times, and how the image of Dalits evolved in the Indian fictions. And another one, after the poet Hira Dom, there was another author, you know, Mohini Chamarin, okay, the first Dalit woman writer of short story, okay, Dalit woman writer. Once again, this information may help you. Mohini Chamarin, you will find some information on Chamarin as well in that famous book. It's a very celebrated book of criticism by Charu Gupta, much acclaimed book. I have referred to it in the slide also. The Gender of Caste. Because many of you are interested to work on Dalit feminism, representation of Dalit women in literature. So it's an important book, The Gender of Caste, Representing Dalits in Print, published in 2016. So it's a very important book by Charu Gupta. That was the first work by a Dalit woman writer, Mohini Chamarin. Title of the story, Thieves of the Subordinated. Thieves of the Subordinated, published in August 1915 in the Hindi magazine, you know, Kanya Manoranjan. And Telugu Dalit poet here, Bhagya Reddy, who also wrote a poem in 1934 after the Pune Pact. In fact, we have a few lines of that poem. We have a few lines of that Dalit poem, Telugu Dalit poem, Bhagya Reddy. I read a few lines. And it's available in the Oxford University Press publication, Oxford Anthology of Telugu Dalit Writing. Okay, so if you are able to collect that book, you will find this poem by Bhagya Reddy. I read a few lines. We are 7 crore people, beware. In 1934, Bhagya Reddy, the Telugu Dalit poet, says, we are 7 crore people, beware, 7 crore Dalits. We are now empowered. The stream of reform flows swiftly in favor of the scheduled castes. Way back in 1934, Bhagya Reddy writes, the stream of reform flows swiftly in favor of the scheduled castes. Who can swim against the tide? You should adjust yourself like the reeds do in swift currents. Look at the note of warning sounded to the upper caste. You should adjust yourself like the reeds do in swift currents, or else you will find it difficult. Or else you will find it difficult. Look at the note of warning. You will find it difficult. Okay. So this is definitely a very important voice of anger and revolt, which we rarely find in Dalit literature. And there is also an image of, you know, the conversion of Dalit untouchable families, okay, conversion to Christianity, and how there was an attempt to, you know, upgrade their status from almost subhuman status to some sort of human status. And it continues, the Dalit articulations in the 20th century. If you look at the history of Dalit articulation, you would find that there were other examples as well. One is by another Telugu Dalit poet, Gurram Jashubha, okay, Gabbilam Bat. There's a poem about the untouchable Madiga community. And if you read that anthology that I have just mentioned, Oxford Anthology of Telugu Dalit Writing, edited by K. Purushottam, If you read Purushottam's anthology, you will come across that poem. So only in 1991-92, we find that coincident with Dr. Ambedkar's birth centenary, because Dr. Ambedkar was born in the year 1891, 14th April 1891. So in 1991, we find the celebration of Ambedkar's birth centenary. And there, you know, Dalit writing began to be translated. It was also the beginning of translation of Dalit writing. No, and Arjun Dangle's Poisoned Bread was translated during this period in 1992, the first anthology of Dalit writing in English. And, you know, there was a clarion call for the Dalit movement. You also know that Dalit literature was a result of Dalit movement, as, you know, the black literature, African-American literature, was the result of African-American movement. So the clarion call of Dalit movement, Ambedkar's Unite, Educate and Agitate, which was earlier also in the mid-19th century, the call was also given by previous Dalit writers, authors. And Siddharth College, which was founded by Dr. Ambedkar, set up Siddharth Sahitya Sangh in 1950. And later it became the Maharashtra Dalit Sahitya Sangh. That was the first, you know, literary association of Dalit writers. Okay. And Ambedkar's death in 1956, immediately after his conversion to Buddhism, was definitely a very cruel blow to the Dalit literary movement and also Dalit political movement. There was a plan to hold a conference, the first conference of Dalit literature under the leadership of Dr. Ambedkar in 1956, but his sudden demise postponed the conference, and it was held in Bombay in 1958. And there, you know, Annabhau Sathe, a veteran Dalit author, a very major, eminent Marathi Dalit writer, presided over that meeting, and he delivered a speech. And the resolution number 5 of that conference, the first Dalit conference on Dalit literature, okay, resolution number 5 was about Dalit literature. Okay, let me have a look at that resolution. And there they decided to, of the conference says, that the literature written by the Dalits and that written by others about the Dalits in Marathi be accepted as a separate entity known as Dalit literature, and realizing its cultural importance, the universities and literary organizations should give it its proper place. So that is important. One area is very important. If we look at the controversy of how could non-Dalit writers write about Dalit experience, and how Dalit authors object to the non-Dalits' representation of Dalits. If we look at the first sentence of resolution number 5, it clearly states that the literature written by the Dalits and that written by others about the Dalits in Marathi be accepted as a separate entity known as Dalit literature. So if you read this section, you can clearly understand that the first literary conference of Dalit literature clearly accepted okay, the writings by others on Dalits as part of Dalit literature. And it began in early 1970s, we know, with the, you know, establishment of Dalit Panthers movement, we know, in the early 1970s, okay, in Maharashtra and later in Gujarat and Karnataka. In Gujarati, we find many Dalit authors and Dalit magazines. Okay, Dalit poets came up in large number. In Karnataka also, Dalit literature developed in a big way. Okay, and it was known as Bandaya Sahitya, that is Dalit Sahitya. Okay, and Dalit Sangharsh Samiti was formed there, much in line with the Dalit Panthers, okay, movement. And there were many, you know, noted writers, okay, who wrote in Kannada and who championed the cause of Dalit people in Karnataka. And recent developments, I have just mentioned that Mandal Commission recommendations and also Ambedkar's birth centenary celebrations, in a way empowered Dalits to assert the caste power. Because I have already mentioned in the early part of my lecture how caste as power has played a major role in Hindu society to determine the production and dissemination of knowledge. So in 1991-92, when the BP Singh government celebrated Ambedkar's birthday, okay, there was almost a resurgence, okay, a revival of interest in Dr. Ambedkar's writings. And in 1992, 20 volumes of Ambedkar's complete works, you know, were published by the Maharashtra government. It was edited by noted Dalit writer Vasant Moon and translated into almost all the Indian languages and definitely into English. Okay, and it helped also in a big way to develop Dalit consciousness at a pan-Indian level. Okay, so this is all about, you know, my presentation on Dalit literature, an overview in the sense that how did Dalit literature develop? No, what were the conditions of Dalit people? How were they depicted in ancient Indian literature and later in the Bhakti movements and also during the colonial period? And how, you know, later, okay, how Dalit movement, okay, gained momentum, and what were the contributions of Jyotiba Rao Phule, Savitribai Phule, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and others, okay, in the formation of a Dalit identity, and how finally Dalit Panthers came into existence, how Marathi literature developed, and how along with Marathi literature, Gujarati, Kannada and other South Indian versions of Dalit literature came up, okay, how they developed. So I have outlined a few very important references. I would advise my students of both these colleges and others also interested in research of Dalit literature, okay, primarily as, you know, textbook, I would like to refer to these you know, texts, K. Satyanarayan and Suzy Tharoor, No Alphabet in Sight, New Dalit Writings from South India. It's a major anthology published by Penguin. Another one is a very popular one. It's a slim volume, but it's an ideal textbook, you know, entitled The Exercise of Freedom, An Introduction to Dalit Writing, published in 2013 by Nabayana, a new publishing house, dedicated exclusively to the publication of Dalit writing. And the third one is edited jointly by us, Tapan Basu of Delhi University, myself, and A. Mangai from Chennai, Stella Morris College, Listen to the Flames, Texts and Readings from the Margins, published in 2016 by Oxford University Press. And another one, a very recent publication, a very important book, I tell you, my students, by Raj Kumar, the current professor and head of the Department of English, Delhi University. The book is entitled Dalit Literature and Criticism, published in 2019. A very important book, very useful book. Okay. So this is all about my presentation. Hope it had served some of your purposes. Hope you have gained some insights from this presentation. And if it had inspired you to pursue Dalit literature in a serious way, if it inspires you to take up Dalit literature as a serious branch of study, okay, I will feel extremely happy. I will feel extremely happy. No, because you know, in fact, several years ago, there was no place for Dalit literature in college and university curriculum. We know at a point of time when we talked about Dalit literature, okay, there were many people who used to, in a way, downplay the idea, in a way, laugh away the idea, that how could it be possible, you know, and how is it, in a way, mainstream? How could it be you know, discussed along with canonical texts? So there were, you know, many doubts and many reservations. There were many biases and prejudices. So I think that Dalit literature has traveled a long way In fact, Dalit literature, the history of the journey of Dalit literature in the higher education institutions of India, in the higher academia of India, can also be an ideal subject of research. Okay, how did Dalit literature develop into a part of the curriculum, particularly in English studies? Because Dalit literature had already been there in the curriculum of sociology, political science, and other allied subjects. Okay, but Dalit literature as part of English studies, okay, has to experience different kinds of exclusion, pain, and humiliation, even in the academia, in the Indian context. So that could also be researched by any researcher, the journey of Dalit literature into the curriculum of English studies. Okay, with these words, I conclude my presentation. Thank you once again, the organizers of Kharagpur College and Agra SSB College, for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with the students, researchers, and maybe other interested colleagues, faculty members. I am happy and I am thankful to you. I am obliged to you that you have lent your patient hearing to me. You have patiently listened to my deliberation. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. This is really an engaging, informative, and obviously well-researched talk. Now, I request our students and scholars to either drop their queries in the chat box or may clear their doubts by asking their questions directly to our resource person. Okay, sir. I can see some questions in the chat box.
Would you just pick and choose, because there are so many, it will be rather difficult for me to pick and choose, but if you help in a way.
Okay, sir. Sir, how many questions can you entertain?
No, anyway, actually, if somebody is in a position to ask me a question directly, I think that is the best option. If the audio quality is okay.
Yes,
I am more comfortable with questions asked in this session. Is there anybody who can directly ask me a question?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, myself Videsh Surat. Sir, myself Videsh Surat. So my question is, the inception of Buddhism after the name of Gautam Buddha has been used as a weapon for the revolution of emancipation of the socially oppressed or suppressed class, as we say, the Dalit class in India, since the 5th century BC.
Yes.
And so then Marxism, which actually evolved in the wake of industrial revolution in Europe in the 19th century, it has also been considered as the worldview that essentially paves the way to liberty for the proletariat class.
Yes.
Now, one can pertinently raise the question whether Marxism or Buddhism, the first way of emancipation for these Dalit or proletariat or the marginalized class.
Yes, yes.
This is my question, sir.
No, just you repeated the last part of your question. Yes, the last part.
Whether Marxism or Buddhism, should we call the first way of emancipation for the suppressed and oppressed and repressed classes?
Yes, definitely. Although in a way, Buddhism and Marxism are in a way separated by many millennia away. Say there is a huge time gap between the two philosophies. They are essentially connected by the inherent notion of equality, and what we call justice and social equity. Because if we look at Buddha as a Protestant figure against the discriminatory practices of Hinduism, we find that that was the first major philosophical school which developed the idea of emancipation from the, you know, hierarchy, social hierarchy. Okay, if we say that caste didn't exist at that point of time, if we acknowledge that fact, even then it was an emancipation from what we call social hierarchy, from a highly, you know, unequal social system. Okay, and also maybe an emancipation from the experience of slavery, because slavery was very much there in the ancient times. Okay, so if we look at Buddha or Buddha's philosophy as the first democratic voice, which also suggests emancipatory identity for the socially oppressed classes, okay, and then switch over to Marx, okay, in the 19th century, we find that one common feature is the idea of liberation, idea of emancipation from the cloistered and very rigid, you know, class-based discriminatory structure. Because in the Marxian discourse as well, we find how there is a hierarchy between, you know, the producers of what we call the product and the consumers of the product. We find how there is a distinction between, you know, the capitalist rulers of the modes of production, and on the other hand, the oppressed workers, the proletariat, who are the victims and yet the chief producers of the goods. So in a way, it also develops a democratic philosophical, you know, structure which suggests emancipation from an unequal structure, from inequality, from social injustice. Okay, from the injustice in the production behavior, from an injustice in the domain of economic distribution of wealth. So either social distribution of privilege or economic distribution of privilege, the way we put Buddha or the way we put Marx, okay, both of them are linked together in the common discourse of what we should call the assertion of human rights, specifically for the disempowered classes.
Okay, sir. So then, is it or it would be, would it be helpful to go for the lengthy discussion for this discourse of whether Buddha or Karl Marx regarding Ambedkar's essay, Dr. Ambedkar's essay, Buddha or Marx?
Yes, definitely.
Would that essay be helpful for
definitely
better helpful. Understanding?
Definitely helpful, because Buddha and Marx are both in a way linked in a kind of ideological, common ideological framework. And the way Dr. Ambedkar comments on the usefulness of studying Buddha vis-a-vis Marx should definitely enlighten any researcher about the real dynamics of what we should call emancipatory politics vis-a-vis the oppressive forms of the exclusion.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Any other question?
Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Hello.
Is it Palak or is it Stuti?
Stuti, hello. Stuti here, okay. Sir.
Please, yes.
Sir, my question is, in the Dalit literature, the whole genre of Darizira, is there any reinterpretation of the ancient Vedic philosophy from the angle of Dalit literature done by any writer?
Ancient Vedic philosophy.
Reinterpretation of ancient Vedic or Vedantic philosophy in or within the whole gamut of Dalit literature.
Actually, reinterpretation is definitely there, because if you read Dr. Ambedkar's prose, okay, you will definitely we understand how he reinterprets the Hindu or the Vedantic idea of moksha. Okay. Mm-hmm. And you would find how the idea of emancipation is confined to a certain section of population, the privileged few. Okay. So the Vedantic notion of universal emancipation, that is Jivatman, merging with Paramatman. This idea is not generally accepted by Dalit authors because of the inherent, what we should call, exploitative system of Hinduism, which generally didn't provide access to the learning of Sanskrit language and literature to the untouchables. How the knowledge that was embedded in the Vedas through the language of Sanskrit was denied access to the Dalit people. So in a way, that for a long period of time, the untouchables, who were also virtually enslaved by the upper castes, didn't have any access to the Vedantic knowledge system. Okay, that was one thing. Another thing was that later when the scholars like Dr. Ambedkar, who had also read the Vedas, came up with certain rituals that were written and codified in the Vedas, certain food preferences, certain drink preferences, and certain cultural practices in the Vedas, however, interestingly, which were upheld by the Dalit intellectuals as some kind of practice, which were later discontinued by Manu and other Manubadis in the name of Brahminism. So, you read, the writings of Ambedkar, say Namdev Dasal and some other leading Dalit authors, you will find that there is a reinterpretation of the Upanishadic philosophy, also in the light of the fact that such universal philosophical realizations of the Upanishadic rishis were also interpreted by the later Brahminical orders for their vested interest.
Okay. Hello?
Yes, hello.
Sir, but also we can see in the lives of bhakti poets that there is the Upanishadic ideology followed in their lives, where there is always a merging of soul with the oversoul. Yes, so definitely. In that form, it was always present.
It was always present because that the bhakti saint poets, like Chaitanya in Bengal, were never in a way away from the main principles of Hinduism. That means that they were never self-declared outcasts of Hinduism. Rather, what happened that many of them wanted to integrate and in a way unify particularly the lower strata of Hindu society into the main ideological practices of Hinduism. That is through Vedas, Vedantas, Upanishads, and other allied texts.
Okay.
So the bhakti saints were very much in favor of reclaiming the original Hindu identities of the untouchables, of the excluded populations. So that was there. But their attempts often failed because of the high-handed imposition of Brahminical order. That often happened. But they were definitely, in a way, attuned to the highest philosophical tenets of Hinduism. Yes, no doubt about that.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, from
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, I have a question. Like, sir, back in the days when Dalit literature was written, it was written initially by men, but later it was also means women also started writing about Dalit literature. So women were always seen as a, of course, as a lower strata in the society, even by the Dalit men and of course by the upper caste men, and they were like the used body. So can I have a word with you, like what do you think about redefining Dalit women as redefining Dalit patriarchy?
Redefining Dalit patriarchy, role of women, but look, Eve, if you have followed my lecture, you would find that there had been some female voices heard in the domain of Dalit writing, say as early as 1855.
Yes, sir.
Say, think of the pioneering reformist works of Savitri Bai Phule. Okay, and later I have referred to the first Dalit woman writer, a student of that Savitri Bai Phule school, okay, who was writing in 1855 about the monks and Mahats, and how she was, you know, vigorously inspiring her fellow, you know, girl students to come up, to educate themselves, to empower themselves, and to assert their identity against male hegemony. Okay, so, and if you look at the writings of other...
Yes, sir, one is Mohini.
One is Mohini Chamarni, you know, in 1915.
Yes, sir, 1915.
1915, Mohini Chamarni is writing about the plight of the untouchable women. Okay, so in 1855, in 1915, okay, so we find that Dalit women had already made their presence felt in the domain of Dalit writing in the 19th and 20th centuries. Okay, so they had been there. Okay, so it's not that, you know, that Dalit women's voices were not heard at all in the domain of Dalit writing. Okay, and if you look at the institutionalized way of writing, that is writings available in English translation in the 1990s, if you look at that, you would find that along with the male Dalit authors, we would also find, you know, Bama and others. You know, we find Urmila Power, okay, and we find many others.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Many others. And even in Bangla Dalit writing, we find some of the women writers, okay, who have come up in a major way, like Manju Bala, you know, and like others, you know, Kalyani Thakur, okay, who had been writing since 1980s.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Any more question? Yes. Chinmoy, would you like to read out any other question?
There is a question from Pooja Datta.
Yes.
According to the information, most of the manual scavengers are Dalit.
Yes.
Do you think after so many years of struggle, Dalit status had improved? Can we say that the prejudice about Dalit in people's mind had erased after so many years?
No, actually, this is definitely, thank you, Pooja, for a very good question. But as I have been discussing during my deliberation about the, you know, philosophy of the state makers, okay, I have been discussing about the conflicting philosophies of Gandhi and Ambedkar. Okay, so if you look at the philosophy of Gandhi, particularly regarding the practice of Varnasrama Dharma, okay, you will find that Gandhi is essentially in favor of retaining the Varnasrama Dharma in the spirit of Karmasrama Dharma, that Varnasrama is Karmasrama. Now, if you go by this, you know, rule of Varnasrama, then what happens? That it becomes a hereditary profession. What happens that any, you know, caste, intra-caste or inter-caste competition, particularly inter-caste competition, is strongly not encouraged. So there is no scope say if a philosopher like Gandhi supports the practice of Varnasrama Dharma, then it becomes a kind of hereditary occupation. So if the state policy is in favor of continuing certain hereditary practices, okay, then it becomes very difficult to rise above the state practice, okay, challenge it, and have the guts to change it. And another very important thing that Dr. Ambedkar said, that due to, you know, the lack of access to the system of education, particularly to the English education, the lack of access for the untouchables, you know, that many Dalit children, in fact, Dr. Ambedkar as a child was not allowed to sit with other children, upper caste children, inside the classroom. He had to sit outside the classroom. Okay. He had to sit on the ground. And he could drink water, he could get water only if the Dalit peon of the school was present on that day. Otherwise, he was even denied water. And you will be surprised to know that after independence, when Dr. Ambedkar was the law minister of India, okay, and he was, you know, a very highly educated person. He was educated in, you know, London and also in the United States, okay, in Columbia University. So when such an erudite person, a member, a law minister, okay, when he visited one province of Mumbai, because there was reports of caste-based violence, when he visited that place, okay, for a scrutiny, for a supervision, for an inquiry, he was a member of an inquiry commission. What happened that there was no rickshaw puller available outside the station to receive Dr. Ambedkar and take him to the village where the problem has cropped up. No rickshaw puller was willing to take him to that place. Why? Because he was an untouchable. And the other rickshaw pullers were members of the upper castes. So if the law minister of India, okay, is denied by the upper castes, if this is the experience of the law minister, which he recorded in his autobiography, Dr. Ambedkar, waiting for a visa. Okay, if you read that autobiography, you will come across many such incidents of humiliation experienced by Dr. Ambedkar. Okay, so if the law minister experiences this, then it's no surprise that such people, the untouchables, the so-called, you know, former untouchables, I must say ex-untouchables, the ex-untouchables will have to continue in such professions generation after generation. Okay, if we don't change our policy, no, or if we in a way create such a mechanism, an oppressive mechanism for the low caste people, okay, that they don't have any emancipatory, you know, idea, any emancipatory profession, you know, any way to move away from such practices. Okay, very difficult to do that.
Gobind Bhakta, sir, ask two questions.
Hello, yeah. Sir, I have one question.
Yes.
Sir, first of all, thank you for such an enriching session. My question is, as we have seen, many Dalits been transformed to Christian religion, but yes, don't you think Christianity does not have any such great impact on the lives of Dalits or their literature?
No, Christianity, you know, when it first came to the Indian subcontinent, Christian missionaries did wonderful work, especially in the remote nook and corners of the country, especially in the Dalit and tribal dominated heartlands of India. Okay, because if you take a record of the Christian missionary schools and the health centers and many other basic facilities, if you take a record of the facilities available in the many remote areas of India, you will be surprised to find the number. Okay, there was quite a large number of schools, academic institutions, okay, health facilities, and many other things, you know, established in the tribal dominated, Dalit dominated areas of India. Okay, so it's a fact. Okay, especially in South India, in the Chotanagpur Plateau region, okay, in the central part of India, and also in the Northeast. Okay, most eminently in the Northeast. Okay, if you take a survey, if you make a survey of the different activities of Christian missionaries, okay, you will find that they had done wonderful, you know, charity work in these areas over a significant point period of time. Okay, so it's true that they had done a lot of things, and apart from that, the missionaries had also been instrumental in the translation of the folk literature of the tribal and Dalit people. Okay, say for example, the folk tales of Santals, the Santal folk tales translated by Reverend P.O. Bodley,
yes,
or say Encyclopedia Mundarica by say Reverend Kaufman. Okay, so if you look at the history of translation of tribal and Dalit literature, you will find that there were many Christian missionaries involved in the act of translation. Okay, so they definitely represented the cultural, social, you know, and in a way the religious life of Dalit and tribal population. Okay, there is no doubt about that. But at the same time, okay, the conversion of Dalit people into Christianity itself created a new hierarchical order, because people, yes, who were converted to that new religion were all from this existing caste-ridden structure of Hinduism. Naturally, when they moved to a new religion, they also moved along with that baggage of a very structured and hierarchized religious system. So what happened? That it might have been a new religion like Christianity, but it was once again the old wine in a new bottle. Okay, the old practices of Hinduism were perpetuated once again in Christianity. And you will find this experience, you know, poignantly narrated in Bama's Karukku. You know, Bama's Karukku is a narrative of disillusionment of a Christian nun, okay, a Dalit Christian nun, okay, who had been converted to Christianity and who also, okay, spontaneously took up the profession of a nun, but who ultimately discovered the same hierarchized structure in Christianity, in the schools, and also the discriminatory practices of the senior nuns, and how greatly disillusioned she was, and how she was forced to quit the Christian church and give up the profession of a nun.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, then.
Sir, there are
two more questions.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let them be the last question. Okay, so probably we have been continuing this session for a long period of time. Actually, I would advise you one thing. Those who had posted your questions, I would request all of them,
yes,
to send their queries to my official email ID. No problem, because my official email ID is already given on the website, Vidyasagar University official website. If you go to the faculty profile, you will find my official email ID. No problem. Send me emails. Okay. I'll be happy to respond to your mails. Okay. And now the last question. Okay.
Yes, sir. Dalit is averse to concept of Hinduism. Even in the Gita, it is mentioned Sudras are given a right to read out. Sir, do you think this idea should be rectified?
Right to, yes, this is a good question, but Shudras are given the right to read out, yes. So that means that Shudras are included in the practice of reading, into the practice of reading, which was earlier, you know, denied to the Shudras and Ati Shudras. Okay, they were not even included in the practice of reading and writing. Okay, that they were beyond the domain of epistemic practices. because the upper caste had the fear of, you know, a kind of epistemic violence, which they didn't allow the Shudras and Ati Shudras to indulge in. Okay, so in a way, Gita offered certain prescriptions. Gita offered certain prescriptions, but at the same time, you know, that beyond Gita, if we move back to, you know, the times of Vedas and Upanishads, and even before that, if we move on to the times of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, okay, which are generally accepted as, you know, Dravidian culture, okay, that is essentially Shudra culture. If we go back to the Harappa and Mohenjo-daro cultures, okay, we find that in those times, okay, Dalits had many rights and privileges. Dalits had many emancipatory practices, and Dalits were also producers of knowledge. Okay, the Shudras were also producers of knowledge, and they were great engineers, great scientists, great developers, great planners, great architects. Okay, so that had happened in the ancient civilization. Okay, so it's not like, you know, a particular period which might have been influenced by the Brahminical culture and might have issued certain regulations to proscribe the free practices of Dalit communities. It might have happened in one era, but once again, there are certain counter eras in which such practices have been challenged, and certain, you know, emancipatory ideas have been floated for the Shudras, and rather the Shudras have reclaimed certain emancipatory practices, as it had happened in the 19th century in Kerala, when we come across a great Kerala Malayalam leader, an agrarian, you know, lower caste leader. He was the great leader of the first Dalit revolution in Kerala, okay, Ayankali. Ayankali was the great leader, Malayalam leader, who led the first successful protest movement, Dalit protest movement, against the atrocious practices of the upper caste Brahmins in Kerala way back in the 19th century. This is something which we have come across in the history. No, it is never to be endorsed. Such practices could never be accepted, especially in a democratic country like India, where the principle of liberty, equality, and fraternity have been ideally being realized and embedded in the constitution itself. The principle of equality is enshrined in the constitution itself. Okay, so definitely this is something which we should never accept. Anyway, so we it's almost five, you know, we have spent
It is really a long and hectic session. So let us move towards the Thanksgiving session. First of all, on behalf of the Department of English of both Kharagpur College and Agra SSB College, I, Chinmay Mandal, would like to thank Professor Indranil Acharya, sir, for giving us his kind consent to deliver a lecture in our online lecture series for our students and obviously scholars. It was really an informative, illuminating, and awestruck talk, sir. And you enchanted us with your sagacity and sapience. It has always been a matter of great pleasure, sir, to listen you. And hope we will get your kind consent again whenever we will try to organize such online or offline lecture series, sir.
Yes, it will be my pleasure.
And finally, I would like to thank all the students, teachers, organizers, and scholars across the globe for their kind cooperation. And with these words, I do hereby declare the end of today's session. Thank you, sir. Thank you, all the participants. Thank you.